160. He's gone.
What's up, everybody? My name is Max, and this channel is MaxWorks. And today, I'm going to be showing you how to rebuild a PCM40i inline boat transmission. Behind me on this Dexter-style table is a few things that we're going to need that you really have to buy for this kind of process to happen. My garage is pretty well equipped, but even I had to buy a few extra tools to do this the right way. So let me talk about some of the stuff that's over here. First of all, you're going to need at least 3 quarts of Dextron 3 transmission fluid. The reason for that is you need 2 quarts to go in the transmission, and 1 quart you're going to need for assembly lube, soaking the clutches, stuff like that. Next thing you're going to need is this. This is Transgel Red. You can buy this for $3 or $4 at your local transmission place, or $10 or $12 on Amazon. This is the best transmission assembly lube in the business. Pretty much all the old school guys use it, and it is excellent. Next, you're gonna need a little bit of black RTV. It's inevitable that you will need a little bit of this somewhere, and so it's good to have some. Whenever you do a transmission, I always recommend redoing the rear main seal on your engine. This is a standard Chevy 350 RMS kit. You can pick this up, it's about $20 from your local AutoZone. This is nothing more than a squeeze bottle full of clean transmission fluid. You're gonna need this for assembly. I bought several of these. These are 99 cents each at Harbor Freight. 6 sets of brushes. You're gonna destroy probably all 12 cleaning the transmission. This right here is a magnetic retriever tool. They're about $1 at Harbor Freight, and for whatever reason, they never survived the project, so I always buy a new one. Now, specialty tools back here. We have specialty tool number one that I had to buy, and it's a 2-pound slide hammer. Basically, the idea is that you can use it to pull seals and stuff by smacking things out. This is a tool you're gonna need. I've been putting off buying one for a long time, but this was finally the project that kind of did it for me. You're gonna need a set of punches and chisels for knocking stuff out. I have some old ones, but they're pretty busted up, so I went out and bought this new set. This was about $12. For the 40A and 40i transmissions, you're gonna need, parts-wise, you're gonna need the RK160014 clutch pack kit. Comes with 7 clutch steels and 7 bronze clutch discs. They're already soaking. You need to let them soak at least overnight in a bath of clean transmission fluid in this bucket right here. You're gonna need the RK173058 oil gasket seal kit. This includes all the gaskets, oil seals, bearing, nuts, snap ring, everything that you need to replace to rebuild the transmission. Now, it's potential to damage some stuff in the transmission that's not in this kit, but this is the overall rebuild kit. Now, just to be safe, I paid and bought one of these. This is a standard transmission oil cooler. I pressure tested the old one thinking it was leaking. I don't think it was actually leaking, and I don't think it was actually the problem I was having, but I went ahead and got a new one anyway. As far as all these OEM parts are concerned, really the only place to get them is a website called Skidim, S-K-I-D-I-M. Excellent customer service, really reasonable prices, and they're pretty much the only people who sell the kit, so you're kind of stuck with them. This guy right here is about $80, the clutches are $240, and the oil seal is $180. So if that's all you need, you're looking at about a $500 rebuild kit. I went ahead and bought this. This is what's called a dampener plate. It's basically sort of like a clutch, but what it does is it sits between the engine's flywheel and your transmission, and these nubs in here are springs, and so as torque is transferred, it kind of softens the blow on the transmission. Now mine was so rusty that I actually shattered and pulled it apart, ripping the transmission off, and this is probably, I don't know, 1/8 inch thick steel, so this is an extra $180. You don't have to replace it if you don't need it, but I bought it just in case because I have to have this done this weekend, and I'm glad I did because we are going to have to end up replacing this. Finally, for about $12, they sell this, which is a hard printed PCM service manual. It's the OEM manual. I'm going to put a link to the PDF of this manual in the description below, but it's always nice to have a hard copy for $12 or whatever it was. They print it on nice heavy cardstock. It'll last several rebuilds. In addition to that, I also printed out an extra set of these diagrams because the transmission manual references the numbers, and it's easier to just have 2 pages so you can look at them at the same time. I am definitely a tech geek, but one thing I've learned is doing stuff like this, your hands are dirty. Computers, tablets, no matter how many PDFs you have, it's a pain in the ass. Buy the paper copy. Now, in addition to that, you're gonna need a variety of hand tools. You're gonna need gloves. You're gonna need a workbench, a separate space. And the best way to do it, I found, is we're gonna clean this table off. And this is nothing more than some sawhorses and a piece of plywood wrapped in saran wrap here. And what we're gonna do is when we disassemble the transmission, we're gonna lay out all the parts here. And as a result, we can put everything back together the way we did. So I'm gonna clean off this table, I'm gonna clean up the transmission, and then we're gonna get started. Well, there's our clean case. Now, throughout this video, I'm gonna do my best to basically keep recording as much as I can with the GoPro on my head, and zoom in and show you guys some important features and whatnot. But the first step was getting it clean. You can see we chipped off a lot of paint. We'll repaint that later. But generally speaking, cleaner case, better the race. So you want to do the best you can to clean everything off. Certain things we're going to clean way deeper once we get them apart, like this shaft and some of these case pieces. But before we cleaned it, you couldn't even tell what this said. But now we've got the pump right here, and so you can see it says up this direction, and it says down here up that direction, because these pumps are universal. They go for either a left-hand rotation motor or a right-hand rotation motor. But this one also has a divot right here, and that divot is what you use, because if this arrow is pointing the other way, the divot's going to be down here. So facing the transmission, when we go to put the pump back later today, hopefully, with the transmission case to the bottom, our divot is going to be up here in the top left-hand corner, and you want to make sure you write that down, notate it, so you don't forget. Divot on the pump is top left-hand corner. So now we are ready to begin disassembly, and the first step is, according to the manual, is to mark this position. So what I did was I used a little pick to basically just scratch this into the surface so we know exactly where this goes. Now, the other nice thing is everything on this boat has been standard up to now, and you guys know I hate standard like SAE stuff, but the transmission itself appears to be all metric because I've gone through this manual a couple of times. So step number one is to remove these 6 13mm bolts. And I'm going to be using an impact for a lot of this. You absolutely do not have to use an impact. And obviously when we reassemble, we're not going to use an impact. But an impact does make it a little bit easier to take some of this stuff apart, because it is kind of corroded. And one of my favorite things is every bolt goes in a baggie. Big parts we can just set down, but the bolts always go in a baggie. So these are pump housing bolts. And then I always put 6 or 4 or 1 or whatever, just to make sure that we get the right number in the bag, the right number out of the bag. And so here we go. You can see I wrote divot on pump top left corner. This is our neutral safety switch, which I already removed. And this is our oil cooler, which I also already removed. And I leave a marker over here so I can write on the table. So this is why things never go quite in the manual, right? In the manual, this cover just pops right off. In reality, I end up having to use a punch and a sledge to basically use this as a pivot point, knock it left and right until it popped out. Now we can slide it off. And it's very important here, remove O-ring and oil seal. And so what we're actually going to do is we're going to leave everything in place, because we're going to replace all this stuff from our kit, and when we replace it, I want to make sure it goes back in the exact same spot. And so we're going to take this and we're going to set it aside on our workbench. Pump cover. It's the little things like this. So right here it says remove the drive pump, pump drive and driven gear, which is these guys. And it's like, oh, you just remove it, you just slide it right off. Except the truth is you don't. It needed a few good whacks with a hammer before it popped off. And so now that comes off. This is our oil pump. So you want to be real careful with this, because it's got to make a perfect hermetic fit. So there's our oil pump. And next we got to use our pocket magnet. Use our pocket magnet to get that out of there. Little check ball. We're going to set that in here. Okay, now that we have all of that out of the way and our shaft is still unscarred and spinning freely, next we remove these 6 bolts. Once again, gonna be
M8 by 30, so they're probably 13 millimeters. Make sure you don't forget these washers, because you can see they're coated in gunk. So now it says that we can remove this by grasping the input shaft and pulling away from the transmission. Okay, let's try it their way. So in the end, a little bit of hammering on the shaft, and we can slide this whole thing out. And here we need to be careful, because this needs to go back on here for now. And this is our gunk magnet. Actually doesn't look too bad, but holy fuck is our filter filthy. Absolutely filthy. So what does this say? It says, next step is to remove the input shaft from the housing. The thrust bearings, which are these guys, should remain on the shaft. Position the housing on the bench with the oil pickup away from you. Oops, those are some more thrust bearings. I'm gonna put those bad boys right back on here. Set that aside. Okay, so the next step for disassembly is we're gonna take this whole thing apart. And in here, this is called the adapter housing. So that's what we're gonna refer to this as. This is the adapter housing. This is the transmission case. So going forward. So it says right here, you remove the input shaft, which we did. You wanna make sure that both of these sets of thrust bearings and washers remain on your input shaft. Then you simply set it aside. So if the inner thrust bearing, remove it from the clutch drum, it might get stuck right here. Just pull it off, put it back on there. Very good note, you can clean this, but do not attempt to remove this oil pickup unless you're replacing this entire unit, because apparently you will fuck it up. So don't do that. Using suitable pin style snap ring pliers, I have these cheap shitty ones from Harbor Freight. I keep telling myself I'm going to buy some quality units at some point, and I probably will, but as of today, this is what we have. So you're going to need to, what is it? Is it like this? Yeah. So you're going to need to put these like that. And the first thing we're going to remove is, see this right here? T2-2 number 56. I don't see a number 56 on here. Let's see. Maybe it's actually on here. Yeah, 56 is this guy. So that's just a typo there. It should be T2-3 number 56. And retains washer number 26, which is right there, and planetary assembly number 22, which is that guy, and remove the complete planetary carrier. So let's do that. So this guy goes in here, spreads like that. This is probably a good time to mention that eye protection and stuff like that is usually a good idea. I just keep my hand over it, which is definitely the hold my beer approach, but hasn't failed me yet. There we go. So there it is, number 56. So we're gonna set it aside. And you can see what I'm doing over here, right? We made a little line. This is our kind of junk pile, and everything here is labeled. So we're gonna do, let's see, adapter housing. Number 56, snap. Let's see, after that there should be a special washer here, which is number 26. And you like the little trick with the magnet? If you need to lift something that's kind of stuck, it's a good way of doing it. I'm trying to wipe all this stuff off. Washer. So we remove the snap ring, remove the washer, and now we are going to remove this whole planetary assembly. And the way this works is it basically takes forward momentum here and then becomes reverse momentum here, and there's a gear reduction, and that's how you have reverse. Looking at this thing, I am less than impressed. It's in good shape, so we can definitely reuse it. There's no problems here, but this casting is just garbage. I don't understand why they would have why they would have used such a shitty casting. Oh yeah, by the way, throughout this manual it says do not use paper towels to clean anything because you might end up with residue in here. But I tend to ignore that because we're going to clean everything meticulously before we reassemble it with compressed air and brake clean and stuff. So for now, I can just dry it off a little bit. Planetary assembly. There we go. Can't write for shit. Ooh, that's a big fucking spring right there. So that's something else to keep in mind. I'm sure we're going to have to disassemble that in a minute, but be careful. So using a suitable screwdriver, remove the snap ring T32 number 48. Where is it? It's that guy. Number 48, which is this snap ring right here, and which holds, what, the reverse clutch plates? Yep, holds the reverse clutch plates. Where's the snap ring brake? Right there. So just kind of do a little shimmy shimmy. A little flexy flexy, and out she comes. So then we're going to remove this pressure plate, which is this guy. And the pressure plate is exactly what it sounds like. All it does is apply pressure to these clutch plates, and the pressure plate is number 29. Clutch plate. Next thing out is the clutch plates. There should be three bronze and three steel. And you can try to work these out one at a time, or we can just do that. And so let's take a look at these guys. These actually look, well, these are the reverse ones, so they don't get used very much, but these actually look pretty good. So the more I'm seeing, the more I'm thinking we probably had a pressure problem more than a clutch plate problem. So this is our reverse stack. So this is where things get hairy, because you could buy a special compression tool for this guy. And that's one option. Or you can use a press, which is option number two. And the option we're going to use, because I wasn't able to find this specialty tool. And so we're just going to have to do it the old school way. So, fuck stupid complicated instructions. I literally spent half an hour trying to figure this out. And so it turns out, you don't really need a press this big. It's just what I have in my garage and what's convenient. So the trick here is this bronze piece has two little nubs on it, two little notches right there. And you actually just lift this off before you even have to press down on this, as far as I understand. And then when you press down, you can see there's a snap ring in here. And so now we can use a small screwdriver to very gently lift up the snap ring. And this is where you need, okay, maybe not gently lift up the snap ring. This is where you need a set of heavy duty snap ring pliers and a teeny weeny screwdriver. Remember, snap rings rotate, so if it's kind of in a bad position or something, you can always just rotate it out. You want to make sure you don't mess up the surface, which is why I'm trying to be super duper careful on how I lift that snap ring up. There we go. Now remember, this is under a shit ton of pressure right now, so we gotta be very, very careful letting it out. We can take all this off, leave it over here, take this back to our workbench. Now, part of the reason why this is a nightmare is because here in the instructions, it doesn't really explain what you're doing. And so you take off this bronze piece, oh, and then you take off the snap ring, and then you pop yourself in the fucking hand, and then you set everything aside. So let's see, toothy part up, and you can see I actually slightly damaged this. This is the part they refer to as 26A that's not in any of the diagrams. As you can see right here, it says, where is it, 26? Yeah, compressed reverse clutch spring retainer washer 26A as follows. And it tells you to use that special tool, which obviously I don't have. Spring. Now that this is out, we should be able to remove this whole reverse piston assembly. And to do that, if you do it right, you can see our piston popped out. So now if we just, so we finally got this piston out, and this was a nightmare. So normally stuff like this, you hit it with compressed air, the outer seal pops, then you basically just smoothly remove it. Now this one has a weird taper step here, and so it says in the manual, if you can't get it out, you got to use some of these and only grab onto this inside edge, and then I basically had to twist it and just work it off, and it was brutal. This is probably the most brutal piston I've ever removed. So this is our dead marker. The cool part is all this shit right here, that is all that goes into this adapter housing. We're done. We're not touching these bearings. We are done with this, and now we can move on to the main case. So position this so that it's facing you. Tighten these guys up a little bit. There we go. Grab the baffle plate and pull it out. Next step is we got to remove the Ford clutch pack. And the first step is to remove its snap ring, which is this guy right here. Again, just gently work it out with a big screwdriver. No problems. Next, we're going to remove all the other Ford clutch stuff. So there's our pressure plate, and we're starting to see where some of our failure may have happened, because there is a little bit of browning on this thing from a little bit too much heat. There should be 4 steels and 4 bronzes in here. Ooh, yes. These got kind of toasty. And that is why I buy a new one of these for every fucking project. So if we take a look at these got real, real toasty. The clutch plates themselves actually don't look that bad. It looks like the steel's got pretty hot. So there's our forward stack. Remember how I started the day wearing gloves and I told you no matter what you do, your hands will end up dirty as fuck? This would be why your hands end up dirty as fuck. Turn the transmission so the output coupling flange is up and facing you. Oops. That would be this guy. Output coupling flange up and facing you. Using a suitable tool, unlock the flange retaining nut from the output shaft groove. I'm guessing that's what they're talking about. And what we're going to do here is we're going to a screwdriver to pop this back out, perhaps, or maybe a pick. This says to use a 36 millimeter, but that's actually if you have the overdrive one, the 40A. We actually need a 30 millimeter for the eye. And a very big impact. So once we removed the nut, there was a washer underneath it. Let me show you that. So there's our output nut. The new one comes in the kit because we see we broke it. And this is the washer. It's quite a thick, heavy washer. So we're going to set that right there. A suitable puller may be required to perform this removal. Move the coupling and washer from the output shaft. So next we gotta do that, I think. We drop this guy out, we can set that aside. But I think we actually have to get this off, maybe? So we gotta pull this coupling, and it says don't hammer on it, which makes sense, because you're gonna break something. And if I was a rich guy, I would have a special pulling tool that flush mounts here and then yanks this out. But I'm not a rich guy, so all I got is some bolts. What to do when you're not a rich guy and you gotta pull something. The old threaded rod method, as I like to call it. Seriously, is this one nut? Oh my god. This is what happens. So what you want to do is tighten that and then tighten this like a couple turns. And then grab this guy. Tighten him a couple turns. But hopefully our bolts are not too short. Otherwise, I'm probably going to kill myself at this point. Well, that's it for the the bolts, I think. God damn it. Well, a little bit of pressing and a gentle hammering from the backside through here, and she popped right out. So now we can set this over here. That is our output flange. And let me check the manual, but I'm pretty sure that's it for the case. Then attach the output shaft. So this actual instruction is for the one with the reduction gear drive in the back. This transmission doesn't have a reduction gear drive in the back. So remove the O-ring, shaft assembly, don't have any of that. The drum aside. Okay, so we're basically done with this. Obviously, we're going to clean it up quite a bit later. So once again, we got to enter the danger zone with our hackery here. Basically, you want to compress this forward spring piston just far enough to get these bad boys in here and get this thing, this snap ring, out of here. There we go. You can see it popped off. Now we can very gently release pressure, the hell of a spring, and set our little compression tools aside. Take this back to our workbench. Snap ring, retainer, spring, and put this over here and just label this forward spring assembly. Next, took the output shaft out, just hammered it from the inside. Not a big deal, came right out. Now the issue we're having is that I can't get to the master pneumatic port that basically runs through here to here, because this thing is just fucking stripped out and I don't want to remove it because I don't have another one. So the reason I'm making these videos is because the instructions for this transmission fucking suck a dick. So basically, to get this piston to unseat, you have to put this back in the casing, make sure it's seated all the way flush, put this in the forward position towards you, and then this hole right here is actually the master pressure line, and that'll pop the piston. So now we can actually remove this whole assembly, set this back aside, and start working on getting this thing out, because it's probably going to be a huge pain in the butt, just like the last one was. So we're gonna have to use lock pliers and get this guy out of here. Now this one was actually a lot easier because you have these little holes on the outside of the drum that just fit a screwdriver. And so this guy came out nice and easy. So we're gonna wipe him down. The final piece of disassembly is to remove these kind of locking rings. And you just want to very, very gently work them out. And that's it for this guy. So we can put this over here. So this is what remains, our intermediary shaft. Don't forget you got these bearings on here. This guy, you don't have to break it down unless there's an actual problem. So we gave it a good inspection. It's pretty good. This part's really dirty, so I'm going to have to clean that off before we reassemble it. The nice thing is this whole assembly can just get right here and we don't have to do anything to it. So next we're going to move on to disassembling the control valve, which is this guy up here. This is really the final step of disassembly. And so we're going to use gun to remove this nut right here and lever from the control valve. So this is a 17 millimeter. Burp-a-derp. Go. There is a nut, a washer, and then this shifter arm. And then we're going to remove a snap ring that retains the control valve, which is that little guy in there. So we're going to grab these boys. So camera can see in there. Let me lay this down for you guys like that. See right in there, there's a snap ring. We're going to put the pointy ends in. So there we go. Now we got our screwdriver in there. Use a second screwdriver to help us pry and get that out of there, and make sure you don't let this go flying away from you, because these things are usually a weird size and they only fit one thing. So that's our, and now that the snap ring, put the shift lever back on real quick so that we can use it to the shift lever basically as a lever arm to kind of work this back and forth. And there is our whole assembly. Let's put this right here, put that right there. Let's see, we got two smalls. Oh no, that's a bearing, I'm sorry. So there's a bearing right there, little O-ring. Whoops. That's a little push rod. So there's our control valve. Yes. So in here is a little spring. We're gonna put that right there, and that's our pressure spring. And let's see if there is anything else metally in there. There's our little washers. And so here you got to be really careful. We have three little washers. Each washer adds about 20 psi of pressure, and you really need to reuse the same number as you used before, unless you're like, hey, I didn't have enough pressure. You can step it up or step it down. But we have three in ours, so I'm going to put three back in when we go and put that back in. So let's see, at least one washer. So we have three. That's pretty solid. If pressure is not within specifications. Okay, so that's it. We have managed to clean out and disassemble this entire transmission. So next step is to clean everything. We're gonna use some degreaser, some brake cleaner, our parts washer over here. We gotta clean everything. And then we can start putting this thing back together. So there we go. There's everything nice and clean and ready to be reassembled. Now that we're ready to start reassembly, the first thing we gotta do is replace this main rear seal. So we got a new one. And so we just gotta get the old one out. So now that we got the old seal out, you can see it's pretty fucked up. Put just a little bit of Transgel in here to help this. And the nice thing about Transgel is it basically blends in with transmission fluid later on. And so you can use it on stuff like this. So next thing we're gonna do is we are going to put in our new bearing. So next we're gonna reassemble this selector valve. And what they recommend is putting the spring and then your adjustment shims, in our case there were three, onto the dipstick, centering the dipstick, and then kind of moving it around until, boom, perfect. Sits right in there nicely. So next we're going to replace the control valve O-ring with a new one. Let me get in there just nicely. Slip that old one right off. And so it says lubricate the outside with a little bit of Transgel. Or it says grease, but whenever the manual says grease, they actually mean, you know, transmission grease, like Transgel. So there we go, it's nice and lubricated. Do not use oil to lubricate O-rings. Apply just enough grease to the pressure relief piston to retain it in the control valve when the valve is held with the piston upside down. Now there's actually, Mother, some grease on there and shove her up the butt. And then wipe off any excess. So you can see it's held upside down. And then lubricate the whole valve with a light coating of transmission fluid. So there we go, nice little light coating of transmission fluid. Position the valve so that the three detent depressions, 1, 2, 3, are facing forward. Oh, yeah. So you want them facing forward of the transmission. Like that, then like that, and like that. So next we're going to lubricate this little thrust washer assembly and drop it in next, just like that. So here's our snap ring, and there's two sides to this, one that's rounded, one that's sharp. You want sharp side out, and then you want just a little help from your friends. just walk that around until it seats in its groove. You're gonna have to push this whole assembly down a little bit. And there you go, you can see it that it's snapped in there. Maybe like this. Go forward and go reverse. Shift lever goes on like that. Then goes our washer. Then goes our nut. Tighten to 5 pound-feet of torque. Now obviously 5 foot-pounds is 60 inch pounds, and so we're just gonna tighten this. There we go. And as you can see, our valve is functional. Boom, boom. And you want to make sure you check this, because this should be about 4 pound-feet of, or 4 pounds of force. So it should basically just move smoothly. So unfortunately, this is where the guide gets really confusing, because the guide was written for the transmission that has the reduction gear in the back. And so it is completely different steps than what we have. So I'm going to kind of deviate from the playbook a little bit here, and we are going to reassemble this rear, reassemble this forward drive and piston. And so that's what we're going to do next. So if we take our piston, and by the way, according to this manual, these pistons are actually identical. We're going to put them back where we found them, but I guess theoretically you don't have to. So you want to dry this off, and then you want to just pop this large type O-ring off and remove the this little baby O-ring out of here. And you want to do it very, very gently, applying pressure only to the O-ring. There we go. So there's our two O-rings. And if we look in our rebuild kit, O-ring number one, O-ring number two. So that's what we're going to do next. We're just going to blow dry this real quick. Install our new O-ring. Ooh, that snaps in there nicely. And our new big O-ring, which is a little big, like it's supposed to be. And now this guy goes down in here. And what we're going to do is we're going to apply just a little bit of transgel to all of these kind of outside and inside surfaces, because you don't want them to leak and you don't want them to start up dry. So you just want a real small thin coat. This stuff goes a long, long way. And just gently kind of and you just want to make sure it goes in there smoothly with that O-ring. And so when you're putting this back together, this is our new snap ring, this is our old snap ring, and take a look at how much of a difference there is in stretch. So the kit comes with a new one, make sure you use the new one. Okay, now we got this pressed back in here. Next step is to put these metal clampy rings on. And again, we're just going to give them a real light coat. And be careful, because their edges feel like they're sharp as all fuck. And you want these alignment marks, as with any other piston rings, to be offset by about 180 degrees. If you can, so one connection is here, one connection is there. Now, let's see if it works. So if we take this and put this guy in there, so there we go. Spins nice. Remember when we were taking this apart, we tested the piston by putting the selector into forward, and you guys see that in there? So So there we go. So we know our piston is fully seated and operating like it's supposed to. So now we can remove this back out real quick. And next, we got to put this output shaft into this housing. And the way it's held on from the factory is with this like Loctite stuff. And so you want to make sure you clean all that Loctite out. Loctite is just the house brand. The actual compound is Threadlocker. I've never seen Threadlocker used on shafts like this, but doesn't really mean much if I haven't seen something. As far as I know, this has got to be basically even right there, just like that. There we go. And so now that we're on, we can take our output flange here. Again, we're just gonna give her a little bit of lube so that it goes in there nicely. And we're gonna slip this on here. So next we're going to catch up with the sub-assembly. So it says, using solvent, clean out the front pump oil seal, which is this guy. So clean out the front pump oil seal, replace the O-rings. Okay. So what we're going to do is we're going to replace this oil seal and just going to collapse it real quick. There we go. Once the oil seal is collapsed, you can just pop it right out. There is our new oil seal. There is our new large O-ring. Apply a small amount of grease in a couple places to hold it in place. Insert the small O-rings into the recess. That's these little guys, and they just kind of go in here and in there. So it says to place these gears in here and give them a little light coat of ATF. Oil pump gears, set the pump aside in a nice, clean, secure place. So we'll put this back over here. We've already done the first piston and reassembled it. So now we're gonna go ahead and take care of this second piston. Cause I apologize, I went ahead and started reassembling stuff, but the way this manual does it is they want you to replace all the seals and stuff first, kind of before you move on. Here's our big O-ring. There's our little O-ring. And we're gonna do just a tiny, tiny smear of grease on everything. So next we're going to place a piston, ribbed side up, in the tower of the adapter housing and slowly force by hand the piston down the tower until it is close to the cylinder. And then we get to play the compression game again. The ball in the adapter housing tower is facing you. Now we got to put the clutch return spring on here. This was not fun. So here, that goes right there. That goes right there, and this snap ring's got to go in there. And so we're going to go back over to the press, and what I think the idea here is that this piece right here has to basically sit over this like that. Now everybody, remember how much of a pain in the ass this clutch spring is? It's like that because you have to actually go down to the second ring groove, and then you have this brass piece right here that basically just slots down in there. What a freaking nightmare, man. Like that. So this guy right here basically just makes sure that spring never pops out. So you want to make sure you hammer this all the way down until this top O-ring is exposed. Also, at this point, we should be able to test this piston. Next, we're going to put the clutches in and the steels. And so what you want to do is you want to start with a steel, dip it in ATF. Obviously, the steels are made out of steel, and so they don't need to be soaked. And then you basically just set it down in there, followed by a brass, followed by a steel, followed by a brass, followed by a steel, followed by a brass. Three of each total. And then we grab our pressure plate and our snap ring. Now the pressure plate is one of these, is just thicker. We'll go ahead and give that a nice little soak as well. And drop that in there. And then our snap ring goes in next. With these big snap rings, you just kind of start on one end and kind of force them into place. Give them a little twisty twist. And like that, you get a face full of fluid. I hate transmission rebuilds. Face full of fluid. Okay. Check the clearance between the bottom of the retaining ring and the top of the end plate. So in there, we're looking for 0.025 to 0.055. So we want 0.025 inch. This is 0.023. That one fits fine. So we use our feeler gauges to measure, and our clearance is good, which is good. Install the planetary assembly into the reverse clutch pack. And here's where it gets kind of a pain, because you gotta line up all of those little teeth. There we go. The trick is to kind of push and then lift a little, then twist and then lift a little and push. And you just basically got to get those in there, bench, and install the tabbed or channeled washer onto the tower. Then the retaining ring are 26 and 56. And this one, yeah. So this guy sits as such. And then again, you get a new snap ring, because take a look at the gap difference on our old one. No bueno. So we got to, there we go. There's our O-ring on. Planetary assembly is a spinning. Our forward piston works. Yay. What else we got here? Slightly grease the gasket surface of the adapter housing. Place the gasket on the housing, set aside in a safe, secure spot. So, I'm gonna set that right there. I'm going to slightly grease the gasket housing. That goes right there. And this is, can be set aside. Well, here's where you need your tube of RTV. You want to put a nice thick coat right back here. This is kind of the washer that is supposed to seal back here. And so that needs to have a nice fat coat of RTV on it. And then you put this nut on, and the nut is really tight. It's not cross-threaded. You put the first few on. Then you just got to go at it with the impact to 150 pounds or till it's tight. Now that the rear nut is Loctited and tightened down, we got the case kind of going up. And so now we have to install the other clutch pack. So it's got four sets. So first we do a steel. Again, just kind of dip them in fluid so they go in there nice. And then we do a brass plate set. And then we have our pressure plate. Just kind of drop something like that. And then we got our O-ring, and our snap ring. And again, you just kind of want to rotate this guy down until it locks in everywhere. And boom, got a nice smooth rotation. says install the magnet into the retainer cast in the bottom, which is this guy. As such, install the baffle plate. We already did that. Narrow end facing away from you. We already did that. Transgel. Let's see. We'll put a little transgel in there. I assume that's what it's referring to. This guy's got some bearings. We're going to put a little rolling of transgel on them. So I think this goes in here. So now that we got that on there, next step is the input shaft, or I'm sorry, the adapter housing goes on there and pulls tightly, sort of tightly. Tighten the 6 bolts, cross tighten the pattern to 10 and then 16 foot-pounds. You just want to make sure you thread them in by hand first, because they're probably going to be a bit of a pain. Even when something you're torquing, it's totally okay to use a little impact, get it tight, get it. You don't want to do that. You want to just get it to where it's and now we will tighten this to 10 inch pounds, and then, I'm sorry, 10 foot pounds and 16 foot pounds. And here we go, 16 pound feet. There we go. Let's see, what does this say? Hint, grasp the input shaft and check for free rotation of the shaft. Pull back and forth on the shaft. There we go. Pump drive ball depression is on top. On top, insert the ball into the shaft depression. There's our new little ball. Lubricate and install the oil pump center gear onto the input shaft, indexing to the semicircle, not the square relief. There we go. Semicircle relief. Install a seal protector over the input shaft splines. Don't have one of those. A single layer of masking tape. Three pump O-rings are still in place. Index mark that was made during assembly. There's our index mark. There's our little groove. So yeah, you can see how there's a blank spot here and a hole here. There's our little index mark. Need to make sure our little O-rings stayed put. They did. Now we can just line this guy up. And you can see our little index marks are almost exactly correct. I'm going to take just a little punch, just give it a few. Little taps until it's perfect. Now all our holes line up. There we go. These are all torqued down to 16 foot-pounds. We have just a hair of play, which is what you'd expect. Free rotation in both directions. It's actually a lot easier than it looks. My hands are just exhausted by this point. Good focus there. Right in here, we can return our neutral safety switch back in place. Actually, before I do that, let's see. There was a little O-ring here, and we have a little O-ring left over. Looks like it's about the right size. Maybe just a shade undersized. Not sure. Because these kits are designed to go either way, there is stuff that's left over that's not used, so that's totally normal. Let's see, I'm just gonna thread this bad boy in here. And there's probably a torque setting spec on this as well, but I took it off with this, and I'm gonna put it back on with this. There we go. Nice clicky clicky. So we know that's good to go. Next step is we got to get our new oil cooler in place. And so for that, we're gonna have to break these lines loose. So on our new one, we're gonna use a little Teflon tape to seal these bad boys up. And this, of course, is the red Teflon tape, which is designed for high temperature use, because these should be somewhere in the 170 to 180 degree Fahrenheit range. So you definitely want to use high temp. Well, there's our transmission ready to go. We got our two cooling couplers. We can rotate, and there is a bit of end play in here, which is what you want. You want just a little bit. And our marks are lined up. So first step is to remove these bolts. So these two bolts hold our electronics in play at the very top. You need to remove them to remove the entire assembly, but they're not bolted to the block. And then you have these two long bolts that go on either side. See, right down there and right down there. Then you have this one less long bolt that goes right up here. Apparently I was wrong. There's one more bolt on this side, way down here. And it's very important because it's got a ground on it. So you need to make sure that when you put everything back, you put all these grounds. There's three different ground straps that all terminate right there. And just like that, out comes. Fuck. So that is what a completely fucked dampener plate looks like. Thankfully the one we got is a lot more heavy duty, but this is just garbage. I've never seen something like this rust this bad. There we go. That's what it looks like when you get all the flywheel bolts out. And so now we're gonna replace the rear main seal, I think. Well, there we go. The new rear main seal is in. Means, at least for today, we're done on the boat. Move back into the garage and work on the stuff we took off. Well, after going at it with a wire wheel and a grinding wheel, we got this back part completely off. And we got this, as much of this paint and stuff cleaned off. I'm gonna give it one more go over with brake clean, get it as clean as possible, and then we're just gonna spray it with some black high temp paint. So there we go. We just kind of went over this with a little high temp black paint. Doesn't look the best, but should keep it from rusting. And now here's our final challenge for the day. We got to get these three bolts out, and obviously I'm gonna go and buy new bolts tomorrow to reassemble all this. But we got to get these out because those are the correct mounting holes. Well, there we go. We got our flywheel all cleaned up. Got our bell housing all painted. Got our new flex plate all ready to go, or dampener plate, excuse me. So I'm gonna go tomorrow, because all stores close now, go buy some bolts and stuff, and tomorrow we're gonna get all this back together in the boat, hopefully running.